Hearing, and thank you to the Conservancy. I want to start out by saying how much I think the nonprofits in this valley have done for the valley. And a lot of newcomers to the valley look at it and don't really understand that it didn't get this way just by accident. And the Conservancy, through decades of work, is one of the reasons why we have the lovely valley that we have today. And Mary, and I can tell you as a former member of the board of the Conservancy that it's a real delight to work with Mary and Heidi and Sarah and Julie and Alyssa and Jason and Mary Morgan and John Sunderland and Jeannie and Bob. It is a smooth running organization, and it's really hard, being on the board, it's really hard to keep up with how fast they move. So thank you to the Conservancy. And I want to thank also Mercedes Evans, who is here tonight from Liberty Bell. She's working with me on an internship and has been helping me with various things during this school year. And thanks to the MERC, it's another nonprofit that we all can be thankful for. Ken Bevins composed two songs to go with this talk. Originally, when I gave this talk at the Wenatchee Valley Museum a few weeks ago, and Ken composed two songs to go with that at the suggestion of the director of the museum, Selena. And so we're going to play those. He had to be gone tonight, so we're going to play the songs, one at the beginning of my talk and one at the end, and one there's an interlude in the middle that goes with with a quote I'm going to read. So Ken is a wildlife biologist and a naturalist who lives in the Meadow Valley. He is familiar with tribes and once worked for the Yakima tribe. And as I said, he provided three songs, two composed to go along with this talk. The first song is called The Meadow Band, and he tried to imagine what it would have been like to have been able to meet a member of the Meadow tribe in the valley before Europeans arrived and before European diseases arrived, but after the tribes acquired the horse. So the tribes, the Meadow and the other plateau tribes, suffered from epidemics and acquired the horse before they ever saw any actual Europeans. So that's the subject of the first song of Ken tonight. Thank you. I started working with tribes about half a century ago, dating myself, I realize, and I was sort of sucked into a vacuum that existed at that time, as working as an expert witness in history in litigation. And so over the past 50 years, I've testified in many cases for tribes and for the United States Department of Justice representing tribes in federal district court, and have testified in Congress quite a few times. And I started working for the Colville tribes. They came, I had an office in Seattle at the time. I served my time in Seattle. And the tribal council sent the chairman and their house attorneys over to meet with me. And out of the blue asked if I would, I'd go to work for them. And they, one of the projects they had dealt with the Methow, with the Moses Columbia Reservation and the Methow tribes. So what I wanted to do before I talk about the book is just give you a little bit of background about federal Indian law and how tribes work within that structure. I think it's, a lot of people don't realize that the Constitution, Article 1, in Article 1 of the Constitution, Section 8, is a provision that gives the United States authority over tribal commerce. And when you think about tribal commerce, that extends to almost every aspect of tribal life. And essentially, the Supreme Court and the courts, federal courts have ruled that the United States has authority over tribes. And that's to the exclusion, in most cases, of states. So in many cases, over the years, the lawsuits that I've dealt with have been a tribe suing a state or a state suing a tribe. And usually the United States, under the law, is required to represent the tribe, especially if it deals with real property, with land, water, or boundaries, something like that. So under the framework that was established with the Constitution, in Europe, for many years, there had been an idea that European powers could discover a new country, and the Aboriginal people had no rights. And there was a big argument in Europe about whether Africans, black people, and whether Indians in the United States, in North and South America, were actually human beings, whether they had souls. And in Spain, it was finally settled by a guy named De La Casas, who wrote a book called Laws of the Indies, in which he argued, finally successfully, that Indians were human beings and did have souls. In the United States, thankfully, that view was not fully accepted, although it had an impact on how tribes were treated in this country. But from the beginning, the United States said tribes do have certain rights, aboriginal rights. They have aboriginal title to their land. Now, it isn't the same thing as the title we have, recognized title. Aboriginal title was a kind of a use right. But from the very beginning of our country, the Supreme Court ruled that before non-Indians could acquire tribal land, aboriginal title had to be extinguished. And it could only be extinguished in two ways. One was by conquest, and one was by negotiation, by treaty, or after 1871, by agreement. So when we get out, the United States had been pushing tribes further west for, you know, nearly a century by the time white people got out here. And in 1871, Congress determined, mainly the House decided, that they weren't going to allow treaties with tribes anymore because the Senate was making treaties that required appropriations, and the House didn't think it was fair that the Senate could demand money and they didn't get a chance to vote on it. So after that point, after 1871, the United States just did agreements. Under the Constitution, the executive office was given authority over tribes. And at the beginning, I mean, today it's hard to tell, but in the beginning in this country, the executive branch of government came from the term execute. I mean, they were supposed to execute the policy that was developed by Congress. And so the president came to be, after the end of treaty making, the president became responsible for establishing all reservations through what was called executive orders. And then Congress had to confirm those at some point, either before or after the fact. So in thinking about what was going on in the 1870s and 1880s in this valley, we have to understand that the first governor of Washington, Isaac Stevens, was told that his first priority when he came as governor in 1853 was to extinguish Aboriginal title of all the tribes in the territory so that non-Indians could get fair title, legal title to the land. And that's why he set out to do treaties with all the tribes. And he started on the west side along the coast, and then in 1855 made it over to Walla Walla and did three treaties there. The Nettow lived in this valley. Their Aboriginal territory, the courts have determined, have adjudicated the Aboriginal territory of tribes. So it's a legal definition that's been established for almost every tribe. And the Aboriginal territory of the Nettow tribe was all of this valley and part of the upper watershed and part of the land along the Columbia River, both up and down the river from the mouth of the Nettow. That was where the people lived. It's hard to know for sure. We don't really have any written records. It's hard to know the population, but it was probably between 2,000 and 3,000 before disease hit. European disease came from both directions. Smallpox epidemics came through the tribes from the east, from the Missouri, across the plains and over the Rocky Mountains and hit the tribes on the plateau. And epidemics also came up the Columbia River, tribe to tribe, band to band, and they reached this area probably in the 1770s. Because we don't have any written records of the Nettow in that early period, we can only compare them to other tribes on the plateau. Typically, I think anthropologists and historians say that most tribes on the plateau lost somewhere between 75 and 90% of their population to disease between 1775 and about 1815. So the people that were here in Nettow by about 1820 were reduced to about 300 or 400 people. And this really had a huge impact on their subsistence practices. They relied upon salmon, and they dug bitterroot, and they had other kinds of berries and plants that they could use in the valley and the watershed. And they tended to move with the seasons. They had villages, there were 20, we've been able to identify the locations of 20 villages in the valley. That at least were there in the pre-contact period. And a lot of those in the early days would have been seasonal. So the people would tend to live near the mouth of the Nettow where it was warmer in the winter, and up in the upper Nettow and its tributaries in the summer when they could get up and hunt and gather berries. Huckleberries, as many of you know, like high mountain, often high mountain berries, including berry country. So by the time that Stevens was doing his treaties in Walla Walla, the population of this tribe was greatly reduced, and their subsistence practices had been dramatically changed. The tribes on the plateau, and including the Nettow, had extremely organized subsistence practices that usually were communally of communal activities. So hunting would involve drives with lots of people involved driving the game, and then a few people with bows and arrows near a blind where they could dispatch the deer or other animals. Once they had their population greatly reduced, many family practices were gone. One family might be responsible for making dugout canoes, another for doing baskets, and so on. And hunting, no longer, there just weren't hundreds of people that could go out on a communal deer hunt. So when the Hudson's Bay Company and the other fur trappers and traders came into the area, it was a huge opportunity for the tribe to obtain guns that one person could go out hunting with a gun, or a small group could go out. And metal pots made cooking really easier, and canvas was an early acquisition for lodges, for teepees, and of course the horse made travel, certain kinds of travel, easier. So by the time of the 1855 treaty, the Nethow people had been living here in isolation, much reduced in population, but for nearly a half a century. And they had been interacting with British, mainly British, trappers and traders who weren't interested in acquiring their land. They were only interested in trading with them. It was a business relationship. Originally, some of the framers of the Constitution, including Jefferson, imagined a policy of what they called the factory system, where tribes, you would trade with tribes, and gradually they would be drawn into what the Europeans called civilization. But by the time the United States power reached this part of the country, they were really not interested in trade at all. They just wanted to acquire the people's land. So the whole effort was to extinguish Aboriginal title and open the territory to non-Indian settlement. The Nethow were invited to the 1855 treaty council in Walla Walla, but did not attend, and didn't know who the United States was, and didn't respect the authority because they didn't understand what this country of Europeans was. It was totally, the concept of owning land was pretty alien to them. So, and they were isolated, and they didn't get a lot of non-Indian visitors. And so that's the sort of background. And so when I was hired by Caldwell, they asked me, one of the questions they asked me, they had several questions. I worked on the Wenatchee fishing rights, which we eventually adjudicated in federal district court, and the tribe won the right to fish for salmon. They now are fishing for salmon at the Leavenworth fishery. The tribe was also interested in the fact that Wells Dam had been constructed on tribal land, and that about 20% of the pool, the reservoir, was on tribal land, and yet they've never gotten any revenue. The DD had never shared any revenue. So that was another long project, which eventually resulted in an out-of-court settlement with the PUD, between the PUD and the tribe, which is being over a period of about 40 or 50 years, probably $400 or $500 million. The project that they wanted me to look at involving the Nethow was the Moses Columbia Reservation. And the Nethow were were subject to what had happened with the Moses Columbia Reservation, although they had not been parties to any of the negotiations. And what the tribe, what the Caldwell tribe wanted to know was if there were any lingering rights that the Nethow or other people might have, people living on the Caldwell Reservation might have on the Columbia Reservation lands. So, as you recall, I said there was a treaty council in 1855 in Walla Walla. The Yakima went to that and signed the treaty. And the tribe, and about 10 or 12 tribes, I'm sorry, I can't list those tribes. I could list all the tribes on the Caldwell Reservation. But the ones that went to Yakima became the Yakima Nation. And under the terms of that treaty, they had the right to fish at usual and accustomed places. So if one tribe had a right to fish in one place, that right then extended to all members of the nation. Caldwell is a little different because it's a confederation of 12 tribes, and each of those tribes, like the Wenatchee, can have separate rights. So the question was, do the Metow have any separate rights to hunt and fish here on their land as a result of the Moses Columbia Reservation? So I did a big report. I interviewed Metow elders in the late 1990s. I took a group of Metow elders up and down the Metow Valley and identified and mapped use areas and village sites and other things that can't be, some of the things like burial places can't be made public. And I did a big report for them that they got in early about 2001, I think. And the attorneys decided that the Supreme Court wasn't right at that time to pursue this claim. And so nothing was done. And over the years, people here in the valley who knew about that work I'd done suggested that I write a book about it. And people at the tribe also suggested that I write a book about it. So eventually I talked to the Schaefer Historical Museum, and the Schaefer Museum thought it was a great idea. The board, Carl and Roxy, I think, are here. And this has been a long project and a very complicated project. In order to approve even the work on the book, the Caldwell Office of the Office of the Reservation Attorney, the History and Archaeology Office, and the Caldwell Business Council, the Tribal Council, all had to agree, all had to approve the manuscript, because they paid for my report, and that's where this book came out of. So in addition to that, we had to figure out a way to turn my expert testimony, which is, I used to say, when I read an expert report, I only care if one person reads it and that's the judge. And sometimes it's a pretty technical report with a lot of legal jargon in it. So what we wanted to do is try and turn this into a book that could be read by a general audience. And fortunately, I had some great help with the book, including Solveig Torvik, who is, I think, here, who helped edit that book and made me think about every sentence in the whole book and try and make it readable and understandable. And Karen West did an enormous amount of research to identify the photographs. We decided that we wanted to try and have photographs in the book that had not been seen in print before. And I think we've been successful in that. And I'll kind of run through these as I talk about what's in the book. So this brings us to the point where the book really starts. The book is really about what happened to the Metow tribe as a result of the Moses Columbia Reservation being established and then opened. First established and then opened to non-Indian settlement. So after the Civil War, and after the Nez Perce War, the military in the West, especially the General O.O. Howard, were sick of bloodshed. They didn't want to be involved in bloodshed. They didn't want to have any more Indian wars. And they wanted to avoid fighting on the plateau. And Howard and military officers started consulting with the various tribes to figure out how they could avoid bloodshed. And Moses had been educated to a certain extent in a Christian school. He could speak English. He may have been able to write a little bit. And he was very ambitious. And he was the chief of a tribe called the Sinti-Use, which now are mainly known as the Columbia. And they were on the other side of the Columbia, on the, what I would call the Waterville Plateau, up in that area, Moses Coulee. And he claimed that he was the chief for all of the tribes on the Columbia Plateau, the Wenatchee, the Chelan, the Impiat, the Nethow. And he had an ally among the Okanagan. And they claimed they could raise hundreds and hundreds of warriors and could cause the United States a great war if the United States didn't negotiate with him and establish a reservation that was satisfactory to him and his people. And so in 1879, negotiations began, and at that time, for inexplicable to me anyway reasons, the authorities decided that this area up here was less attractive to non-Indians, to white people, than the Waterville Plateau, the Columbia Plateau, the dry lands up above the Columbia. And Moses negotiated for a reservation in 1879 that basically went from the Canadian border to Lake Chelan, and from a little bit over the crest of the Cascades to the Columbia River and the Okanagan River. So it abutted the Caldwell Reservation, which had been established in 1872. And the Nethow people were never consulted. They knew nothing about this. They didn't, their homeland was being turned into a reservation. They'd never even heard word that any negotiations were going on, let alone had anybody from their tribe invited. And within a couple of years, by 1882, white people were saying, well, actually, we do want this land. And first of all, they said there was a lot of minerals. There were a lot of minerals up by the Canadian border, and a strip was taken away, and then another strip was taken away, and eventually, in 1883, Moses reached another agreement with authorities in Washington, D.C. And under this agreement, he was to get, I think, $1,000 a year in a new house in return for opening the reservation and allowing non-Indian settlement. So I'm going to shoot through a few of these images before I get to the next song of Kenneth. So the images are really interesting. One of the things I wanted to mention, Kieran found these images in all sorts of different places. One of the locations, I mean, and she has been largely responsible for the Shaver Museum acquiring a huge, remarkable inventory archive of some 4,000 images of the history of the valley. Some of those images came from somebody who worked at the newspaper. Many of you will recall Sue Nassau. Sue was spotted some. Oops, I'm going to have to go back to the word. Sue spotted some glass plate negatives in Seattle that were found at a yard sale by Greenlight. This is one of them, and I want to point out, I have my little pointer here for this sole reason. If you know, we don't know who took these pictures. They were 8 by 12 glass plate negatives. This is the cover of my book, but when they did the cover, they cropped it, and they left this guy out. If you look closely, he's clowning back there. He has a pair of antlers he's holding on his head. He's got one child and a dog back there with him. So these are remarkable photographs. They've never been seen in print before. Some of these, like this one, were by Frank Matsura. You may know Frank Matsura. A lot of his glass plates are at the Okanagan County Historical Society. This is four generations of Met-El people. This is, how many of you know Elaine Tynantwaugh? I mean, there must be some guy. This is Elaine's mother. And that's a horsehair rope that she's got. And those are the ropes holding the baskets, which are, if we had them today, would be worth a fortune, are made from hemp. These are fish corrals, the traditional method of getting salmon. This is one of my favorite photographs. This is a Matsura photograph too. This is a chief. This is, let's see if I can get back here. One of my favorite things about this photograph is that we've seen several photographs of this store, none with the chief in it, but the clock is always at exactly the same time in every photograph. So we know the clock didn't work. This is the very first map that we know about that was made that mapped Met-El territory. And right here, if you can read right there, it says Met-El. This is Met-El territory. This close, the spruce is Wenatchee. This is Okanagan. And this is from 1827, this map. It's the first time it's been published. It came from the Hudson's Bay Company archives in Winnipeg. And so very early on, the Met-El were identified as controlling a large area of land. And they had an important trade partner for the company, for the Hudson's Bay Company. This is Fort Okanagan, established in 1811. I mentioned how important trade in guns and pots, metal pots, became to the people. A.J. Spawn was one of the first white people to deal with the Met-El. He came through in the 1850s, right after the Yakima Treaty, and he was able to basically make friends with the tribes along the Columbia, including the Met-El. There's a group of Met-El that went back to Washington when they were trying to undo some of the stuff that Moses had done. It's another of the Sioux Sal photographs. Lyman Jim, well known. And this is Moses. This is the guy who made the deal. And if you talk to Columbia people in the Columbia tribe, the Sinkings, he's kind of a hero to them. But if you talk to the Met-El people, he's a villain. And we'll get to that in a minute. This is Sarsarpin. He was the unconverted, like he didn't convert to Christianity, he was the unconverted Okanagan. This is Tenasket, who was the converted Okanagan. And basically, Sarsarpin's people were on the west side of the Okanagan River, and Tenasket's people were on the east side. This is Loop-Loop. And I know that a lot of people think Loop-Loop is named as something to do with wolves. It is actually named for a Met-El family, Loop-Loop. And I'm going to read a quote from Loop-Loop, but before I do, we're going to hear another song from Ken. Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. sincere words. The whole people are just the same. We treated you with friendship, then you lied and took our land away. Our world was so good, you stole our future away. We're sad, we're sick, and we're broken. Yesterday's all there is. Yesterday's all there is. Now we're being forced to live on a stranger's land. Ancestors' graves. We tried to live in peace on the river deep in the hills. Our world was so good, you stole our future away. We're sad, we're sick, and we're broken. Yesterday is all there is. Yesterday is all there is. A homeland is lost. A homeland is lost. A homeland is lost.
So in 1883, military officers came out to visit with the Medav tribe and explained to them that the reservation, which they had nothing to do with establishing, was now being opened to non-Indian settlement, including this valley, the Medav Valley, and that the Medav people had a choice of either being removed to the Caldwell Reservation on the other side of the Columbia River, or taking 1 mile square allotments. Unfortunately, the military officer in charge only went to the mouth of the Medav, and it was in the summer. So most of the people were upstream and didn't know about this deal and would have rejected it probably even if they had known. But the officer did meet with this person's, it was probably this person's great-grandfather, the original Lucu, and he came to him in 1883. I'm going to read a report that he wrote in 1883 about meeting with Lucu. The military officer said, "The next morning I had a long talk with Lucu, in the course of which he spoke of Moses with much bitterness and contempt. Said he, there are 4 things above all others which you white men tell us we should avoid. Lying, thieving, drunkenness, and murder. Moses is a liar, Moses is a thief, Moses is a drunkard, and Moses is a murderer. Yet he is the man you have set as chief over us, and he is the man you send to Washington to represent us." So, as a result of the meeting that he had with the few Medav that were down there at the mouth of the Medav, there were a handful of allotments made in that area, and one of those is still occupied by the Miller family. Some of you may have seen the series that Joanna Bastian did in the Medav Valley News called We Are the Millers. And in the museum, we published that series in a booklet called We Are the Medav. And that is how they obtained, that's where the title to that land came from. That is, there's still a portion of that that's what's called held in trust, so it's still tribal land down there. But most of the land, most of the people, most of the Medav were moved from here in 1886 over to the Caldwell Reservation. That's really what the story of this book is about. And I point out in the book that the Medav people still hold this land very close to their hearts. It's their homeland, their Aboriginal homeland is important to them. And they hope to be welcomed here to hunt and fish and to gather roots, to dig bitterroot. to strip western red cedar roots for baskets and use other traditional items to continue their traditional activities. I think they have become a good partner to the people. The Colville tribe in general has become a good partner for the people in the Mentor Valley. They have a lot of the same objectives that we do. They also opposed the helicopter base, a lot of us opposed, and they opposed the mining, the test drilling that was proposed by the mining company would have been almost exactly on an area that was used for vision quests that I identified in my 1990s field work with the Med-Hal people, so long before there was any talk of any mine. So they hope to be even more of a partner in the future. It's important to them when they come over here and they feel welcome, because for a lot of years they did not feel welcome coming back here. Now, before we close, I'm going to kind of go back through a few more of these slides. That's Moses again. The United States did a medal for him. This is the mouth of the Med-Hal in about 1900. The mother of Sioux images, I think. An early image where white people have been fishing with Med-Hal people. This person, when I did a little talk at Fort Okanagan, which is now run by the tribe, by the Pueblo tribes, there was a woman there that identified this man as, I believe, her great-great-grandfather, and he was over 100 years old when the picture was taken. This is Miss Alta, from whom Alta Lake is named. And if anybody can identify this individual, I'd be happy to know who it is. It says a near twist, but he doesn't look Med-Hal to me. And now we've got a photograph of the Med-Hal Valley today from Terry Piper, Ken's wife, who's here. And we're going to leave this up while we listen to the third song of Ken's, which is the Med-Hal band. I mean, my home, the Med-Hal. Med-Hal, my home. And thank you all for coming. And I'll be happy to stay and answer questions. And also sign books if anybody wants to get books.
Fall down, autumn's golden shine. Winter comes quickly, the snow begins to fall. White world, it goes to sleep. To awaken in the spring in my home. in this mad tower, my sweet home. History. Well, native peoples lived gathered through the years, digging roots, catching salmon, or hunt those big and deer. Their spirits lay upon this land, mingled with the trees. We walk their trails, see their skies, feel the mentals peace. Then came the homesteads, the miners, loggers too, the ranchers and the farmers with the land me and you. So many came for us, to them we owe great debt. We'll try to keep this valley fine, but that is work that ain't done yet. No, no, in that town, my home. My sweet home. Oh, do 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 do. Now the future is upon us. Computers, flying cars, the crushing modern world. Here we see the stars. Get out and visit with your friends, the Mercury at the bar, the Salmon Junction or on the trail. Love is never far. Young people laugh and sing, clear eyes and open hearts. Their world is new, their minds are fresh, soon they'll do their part. We make our way together, we celebrate this land. We raise our voice, we clap our hands. And we sing to our home, to our home. Oh, the Mad Town, our home. Oh, the Mad Town, our home, home, home. Wander the world, we found where we belong. In this Mad Town, our sweet home.
And the Conservancy have been holding some meetings with the Gen Next group. I guess I'm the Gen Before group. But the Gen Next group, one of the things, and it's really important, of course, for the Conservancy to involve young people in thinking about what we do, what the Conservancy does. But one of the things they've said is that when you finish a presentation like this, you should give people an opportunity of something to do. What can we do? And so I'm going to mention a couple of things. One is you can buy the book. And I should mention that the author's royalties are donated to the Tribal History and Archaeology Office, and the net proceeds beyond that go to the museum. And what made that all possible was the generosity of Tom and Sonia Campion, who have done a lot for the style and a lot for the museum, and deserve our thanks. And you can also support the Conservancy and the Interpretive Center and the Merck Playhouse. And also, right now, we've just been involved over the past year, actually, and trying to get the creek that has been named Squaw Creek renamed to a Methow name. Tribal people find the term squaw offensive, and there's a long history of why that is. And they have identified the area as an area where they did ice fishing at night, and the word for that is swarm, which has a glottal stop, which I left out. And so we just met last, we had a hearing in Olympia Monday, and the creek has been renamed Swarm officially. Next stop is the road. So if you have, if that comes up and you have a chance to state your opinion on that, I think that how people would be appreciated. So are there any questions?
Richard, I've seen some maps. You mentioned Mizu on the map that you showed. I've seen some maps as well that describe Mizu as the place where we are. Can you tell us what do you know about the history of, or the evolution of the name of our valley?
The question is, the map that I showed identifies the tribal area as Meathow. I think it's spelled M-E-A-T-H-O-W-E. And there are other maps, as Kent has pointed out, that have similar names, Meathow. And it's a linguistic question I can't answer. If Elaine Clementine was here, maybe she could. They all say Meathow now, and it's important that it's two syllables without a TH sound. Meathow. But go ahead, Kent.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
So I was curious because they were moved out in 1886, roughly. But there are photos in 1900, like some of the Matsura photos of, you know, camped out. And so I was curious about, they were still able to come back and
be on the land. Right, I do cover that period a little bit in the book. Carolyn noted that there are photos in the book and photos that I showed that are Meathow people after 1886 in the valley. And basically what happened after, I mean, the Meathow people report that they were moved out of the valley at gunpoint by troops and taken to the Caldwell Reservation. There's not a lot of documentary record of that, but I don't think there's any reason to disbelieve their traditions. However, the people, the original non-Indian settlers in this valley, really got along pretty well with the Indians, and until the 1930s, people came back pretty regularly. There was a racetrack by Twist, and they participated in rodeos and hunted and fished. And then in the 30s, the state started to crack down and arrest people that were hunting or fishing and confiscate their guns or their fishing lines and fishing materials. You know, that was a big change in the 30s. After the 30s, it changed quite a bit. But there have always been families here that were close, non-Indian families that were close to some of the Indian families. So there, I mean, we've had, at my house, we've had people come dig bitterroot a number of times, which is pretty wonderful.
Yeah.
Although bitterroot, if you, is aptly named. And there was somebody in the back? Yeah.
I was just gonna mention, you talked about that population declining to about 300 to 400 people. Right here in the Merck, our capacity is about 150, and we have more than that. So if you just double the size of us, this is 300 or 400 people. That's really not much.
Yeah, I mean, there were tribes, of course, the people didn't have any resistance to smallpox and measles or a number of the other diseases. Flus killed a lot of people. And there were tribes near the mouth of the Columbia, some of the Chinookan tribes down there, that were very close to the early European visitors, both Spanish and English and American. And some of those tribes were completely wiped out. And we do have a little further up the Columbia, Fort Colville, there are some pretty good records there from Jesuit missionaries that were there in the beginning of the 1820s. And we can see tribes there, the lakes, the Sinaiks, were almost wiped out, the Fallville were almost wiped out. So we have pretty good records of some of the tribes that we can compare with this one, and we can extrapolate and say, you know, we think that 75 to 90% of the population was lost.
Can you say something about the Colville tribe, the Colville name, and the names being reconsidered, and the fact that the man was, who Colville was?
Well, Colville was, that's Colville, not Colville. And if you were over at the tribal council, they would say, we don't have any coal over here. Colville was a governor, what they called a governor, head of the Hudson's Bay Company in the early years. And Fort Colville was named for him. And the tribe that occupied that area, actually, that if you've been over there, the falls right there were a border. Kettle Falls were the border between the lakes, the Sinaiks, and the Colville. So the Colville got named for the fort, basically, for the same guy. They are known popularly by that name, Colville. And the reservation, because that was when the United States constructed a fort there after the Hudson Bay Company. Although the Hudson Bay Company fort wasn't really a fort because Indians came and went and traded all the time. The American fort was really a fort with a stockade and troops and guns. And so the reservation, and there's a long story about the establishment of the reservation, but when it was finally established by executive order in 1872, it was named basically for the name of the fort. So there are 12 Confederated Colville tribes. And they include the Wenatchee, the Entiat, the Chelan, the Methow, the Okanagan, two Sahaptin tribes, the Palouse and Joseph's Band of the Nez Perce, Moses, Columbia, and a number of other tribes, the Lakes, and the Colville, and the Nisqually. So
in the book, when it says Colville tribes, it's referring to the Confederated tribes?
Yeah, it's a difficult question because a lot of people, if you ask them what tribe they're from, they'll say, I'm a Colville, and they mean I'm from the Colville Reservation. If you ask them what bands you're descended from, then they say, I mean, they have a card, an enrollment card, and they will put on their enrollment cards the tribes that they, the two tribes that they're most descended from. There's been a lot of intermarriage. That's the second thing that really, the disease had a huge impact on marriage custom, because originally all the plateau tribes, they couldn't marry, they had much stricter rules about intermarriage than we do, second or third cousin. And so there just wasn't a big enough population base. They started, instead of being endogamous, they had to be exogamous, marrying outside of their group. And so, and that happened especially after they were all consolidated on the reservation. So people are all related, and there's a lot of intermarriage. But so some people will say, I'm actually Colville, and some people will say, I'm from the Colville Reservation. Sometimes it's hard to tell what people mean when they respond to the name Colville.
And the discussion about changing a name is about the name Colville? Is it of the Confederated tribes? There's some controversy about people.
They recently changed their name from the Colville Confederated tribes to the Confederated tribes of the Colville Reservation. Uh-huh. And they have also they've adopted the traditional tribal names for all of the 12 tribes. So the Tuscosa for the Wenatchee, I think Chelan is pretty accurate, Entiat is pretty accurate, Methow is accurate, I've forgotten how to pronounce the Colville, the Lakes are Sinaiks. S-I-N-I-X-T. So they, in Okanagan, I think, is stuck with Okanagan. So they're trying to go back to get rid of the English imposed names on them. So the two comments, and I actually want to comment on both of them. The first one was, I'm sorry, I can't see you if I know your name. Jessica? So she pointed out that the Senex territory was half in Canada, what is now Canada, and that it was along the Arrow Lakes, and that Canada declared the tribe extinct, all of which is correct. I testified for the Senex in Nelson in November in a trial in which they claimed hunting rights in Canada. And the Crown responded that they're an American tribe and can't have any rights in Canada. And we won that case. And it's now going to go to the Appellate Court of Canada, and I'm sure it'll go to the Canadian Supreme Court. So it's a really interesting question. The Okanagan also had territory on either side of the border, but Okanagan stayed. Some Okanagans are on the Canadian side and some are on the U.S. side. So there's organization on both sides. Most of the Senites, not all, but most of the Senites moved to the Colville Reservation. My belief is that it was primarily because they had poor health care and they were threatened. I've seen bounty posters, you know, $10 for a scalp up there. But at any rate, that is an ongoing issue. The Colville tribes are very interested in the treaty between Canada and the United States that has to be renegotiated. I can't prove it, but I think that the reason they were declared extinct was to enable the construction of the dams from Trail on up a very large percentage of BC hydro power comes from the hydroelectric dams in that area. And they didn't want to have to deal with a tribe. The second question was, is the United States considered purchasing land in trust for the Menhel tribe in the valley? And I think the official tribal response, I'm not a member of the tribe and I don't speak for them, but I think I've heard it enough, I think I can say the tribe doesn't have any interest in removing or reacquiring any privately held land. They know what it's like to have their land taken away from them, and they wouldn't want to do that to anybody else. They would like to have hunting and fishing rights on what are called open and unclaimed lands, which would be federal lands, like Forest Service lands. That is the only thing that I've heard them desire. They'd like to have fishing rights, but they don't believe that there's been enough salmon recovery to really have fishing up here. They think that there should be more recovery before there's any fishing.
I heard you say that it was a bad time for the Supreme Court to visit your report that you wrote.
Yeah.
Is there a good time? Can that be resolved?
Tribes are vulnerable to decisions from the Supreme Court. I did a case for the Coeur d'Alene tribe, which went to the Supreme Court about 15 years ago. which we won 5-4. Right now, the makeup of the court has shifted, and attorneys try to guess their chances of surviving a Supreme Court ruling if it's new law. So in answer to your question, a lot of these cases, like the Maddow case, if they had pursued that, it might cost $1 million to get all the way through the court. And it's, they just end up thinking it's not a good, the odds are not good enough to pursue it. The makeup of the court has been more pro-Indian in the past than it is right now, although since nobody's pursuing cases, we really don't know what they're going to do. I hope that's a fair answer. One more.
How does the Meta language relate to the other languages?
Well, I'm not a linguist, and there are disagreements about that. The question is, how does the Meta language relate to other languages on the plateau, if I understood correctly? Meadow is a dialect of interior Salish. The people like Elaine can listen to the language as it's spoken by Wenatchee or by Okanagan or by Lakes, and they can identify which tribe they're in, but they can also understand each other. So they're like dialects. To me, it's like if you speak English and try to understand a Welsh person. So it is. I mean, there are disagreements about that, though, and I'm not a linguist. One more, yeah. The Yakima Nation has usual and custom fishing rights. Any place, any of the tribes had usual and custom fishing rights. They don't have usual and custom fishing rights in the Meadow Valley because Meadow is not one of their tribes. However, the Bolt decision, which was the case that allowed tribes to take half of the salmon catch every year. The Bolt decision is enforced by federal court, and the court has ruled that salmon recovery, that all hydroelectric dams have to provide a percentage of their revenue to salmon recovery in order to meet the needs of the treaty. So Yakima and other tribes have a right to work on salmon recovery wherever the salmon might be spawning that eventually would go to their usual and accustomed places. So that's why you see Yakima working on salmon recovery in the valley. The Methow and the Caldwell tribes are also working on salmon recovery. They have slightly different perspectives. The Yakima opposed the Wenatchee fishing rights. I mean, I think there's a long pattern of disputes between Yakima and Caldwell, but I don't think, really, when it comes down to it, I don't think there are any disputes over the matter at all. And thank you all very much, and I'll be happy to.